lives. And therefore, we have two lives which are possible to us. One which belongs to the essence, the more real part of ourselves, and the other to the personality or the acquired part of ourselves. Now, as we grow up and become educated, we have experiences, and as we become older, essence becomes passive, and personality, the acquired part of ourselves, becomes active. Now, life and everything pertaining to it are what build and develop the personality, and this is the state of everyone you meet. It's one of the key ideas of this system that in order to bring about a change in your true self, it has to be done through essence, because essence is the part of you that is actually real. So in the event you take on a new profession, learn a new language, move to a different place, these changes only pertain to your outer life or to your personality. The personality is developed by life, and it has to be. This is the normal part of our development. But life, as we are, does not reach the essence to educate it. And the secret is that essence and personality need different foods for their respective development. They need different kinds of truth, as it were. And to change your being is to make essence become active. And this requires an education of a different nature.
Essence, before it is manifested in a human body, derived from the parents on Earth, comes from a much higher level than the planetary world. It is said that it comes from the stars. If a man or woman continually steeps his or her mind in the truths of a higher nature, that is the teachings that we've been discussing, which come from conscious humanity, or the kingdom of heaven, as it is referred to in the Gospels. So if a person tries to think and think again from these ideas, perceive their depth, acknowledge the truth, and apply them to their inner state, essence will begin to grow. To the extent we can recognize essence, it may give us the possibility of thinking on a higher level and acquiring deeper levels of mind. Essence thus enables us to transform events based on our understanding.
And the formation of personality, the acquired part of us, is a necessity in each person. When we form personality, it allows us to have a vehicle with which we interact to life. We interact with life through our personality. And eventually, from the teachings of our parents and experience in our environment, we build up a library of associations which the brain refers to in order to interpret the constant influx of information. Now, this is the given state for each, and this is how we are by our nature. But the education of our essence is not obligatory or even necessary for our lives. The esoteric work which we study teaches that in the event our essence does not grow, we will attract the same situations in our life. This idea can be expressed by the phrase, your being attracts your life. One's life is not a succession of chance manifestations, but it conforms to an already established pattern. And this pattern may be a result of patterns in the essence. The essence determines the thread of one's life. Now, little by little, though, with work on oneself in a school, personality can become less heavy. This acquired part of us can weigh less on the essence. And our essence can become more free to develop, and eventually qualities will pass into the essence and become permanent in us.
Now, the video that we are going to show will take you through the essence types of the Enneagram, explaining the characteristics of each type, along with strengths and limitations. Now, Rodney Collin introduces our dilemma quite well. So listen to this quote from the book, The Theory of Celestial Influence. Nine-tenths of the problems of ordinary psychology, and even more of the plots of literature, poetry, drama, and legend, depend upon the interplay of human types, that is, the interplay of different types of essence. Since the dawn of history, man has never failed to be fascinated by this mystery, which fills his daily life with hope, envy, fear, pain, admiration, and longing, and the explanation of which forever eludes him. All types are clearly necessary in the world, and life would obviously be poorer, if not impossible, without any one of them. Yet why are some types obviously incompatible, others irresistibly drawn together? Why do some want only to be more intensely what they are, while others yearn ceaselessly to become their opposites? Why can certain types only understand each other in the presence of a third? And so on and so on. All this is unanswerable unless we begin to study mankind as a cosmos and to regard the different types of men as its equally essential but completely different functions. Each function with its own innate capacities, potentialities, weaknesses, and with an affinity for a different and distinct part of the universe. So watch the video and see if you can see your type.
This presentation is an introduction to the six planetary body types. Types are one of the principal areas of self-observation that those who enter a fourth-way school must verify for themselves. It is said that the sun gives us life, the earth gives us material, and the planets give us form. Each gland in our endocrine system is related to a certain planet of the solar system, and this informs one's type. Thus, each type has a predominant endocrine gland corresponding to its predominant planet. This diagram, the enneagram, depicts the six major planetary body types and how they relate to each other. The inner circulation indicates the direction of psychological movement, which is possible for a man working on himself in a sea-influenced school. One aspect of our work in school is to learn how to cultivate the positive attributes of a person's type and separate from the limitations of the person's type or types. Our presentation will follow the movement through the Enneagram, beginning with Lunar to Venusian, then to Mercury, Saturnine, Martial, Jovial, and back to Lunar. We will also discuss Solar, which can be found in conjunction with other types. When a man has moved through the Enneagram, refined certain characteristics within himself, with luck and favorable conditions, it may be possible for him to move off the Enneagram and on to the next higher scale, as the circle becomes a spiral. He will then have become Neptunian man. We will begin with the lunar type. The planet of influence is the moon. The predominant gland is the pancreas. Lunars are passive, negative types. The physical characteristics of the lunar type are pale skin, as pale as the moon, rounded faces, a cool, instinctive stare. They tend to be night people. They may have an underdeveloped part of the body. Lunars tend to have thin hair and rounded bodies. They may like to wear black and white, like the moon against the night sky. Psychologically, lunars tend to be timid. They may have a feature of stubbornness. Lunars may enjoy working at night. They seem to have energy from the moon. As the moon affects the tide, lunars may have a feature of flux and instability and tend toward indecisiveness. They may have a feature of cool and instinctive certainty. Because of the coolness of the lunar, the lunar type may need to develop the positive attributes of the next type, Venusian. The planet of influence is Venus, the predominant gland, the parathyroids. The Venusians are passive, positive types. Physical characteristics of the Venusian type are pear-shaped bodies with heavy hips and thighs, small hands and feet. They tend to have evenness of tone in muscle and nerve. They may have poor circulation causing coldness in the extremities. Venusians tend to be slow moving. This may be connected with growth in inactivity. They may have a sensuous appearance. Venusians enjoy rich foods, green growing things, and sensuous surroundings. They tend to be loyal and pleasant to be around. They may have a feature of non-existence. And while the lunar tends to be the wallflower, the Venusian is the wall. They may have a feature of sloth. Because of the sloth, the Venusian may have to develop the neat and tidy nature of the next type, the Mercury. The planet of influence is Mercury. predominant gland, the thyroid. The Mercury is an active negative type. The physical characteristics of the Mercury are small bodies with bright eyes, even teeth, and thick hair. Male Mercuries like to wear mustaches and goatees. They may have powerful, honey-toned voices.
I got scared, and I didn't say anything, and 10 seconds later, I had a...
Similar to Mercury's erratic orbit around the Sun, this type tends to engage in a lot of aimless movement. Mercuries enjoy the outdoors, and they are called the sunshine people. Psychologically, they are quick and perceptive. The other side of which may be that they tend to be superficial and naive. They may have a feature of power. As Hermes was called the thief of the gods, Mercuries may have a feature of thief. They have many, many eyes, more than any other type, and because of this, they may tend to become paranoid or interconsider more than other types. Because of the many eyes and the tendency to interconsider, the Mercury may need to develop the positive attributes of the next type and learn to dominate the many eyes and aspect of the next type, Saturnine. The planet of influence is Saturn. The predominant gland is the anterior pituitary. Saturnines are active, positive types. The physical characteristics of the Saturnine are tall, angular facial features, large hands and feet. They are known as the bone people. They may tend to lack color and may have a feature of grayness. They tend to sit and not move. The statue of Lincoln sitting in a chair may be a good example of a Saturnine sitting in a Saturnine posture. Psychologically, Saturnines tend to be aloof. Their breadth and wisdom, as well as overview, contribute to their success as businessmen. Their surroundings are generally ascetic. They tend toward vagueness, vague speculation. They may have a feature of dominance and cowardice. Because of the cowardice, the Saturnine needs to intentionally cultivate the courage and aggressiveness of the next type, the Martial. The planet of influence is Mars. The predominant gland is the adrenal glands. Martials are active, negative types. The physical characteristics of the Martial type are wide shoulders and narrow hips, the cowboy image. They tend to have red hair, uneven teeth, freckles, and a lot of body hair. Psychologically, Martials tend to have features of formatory and willfulness. They may have attributes of strength, courage, and endurance. They may have a feature of destruction, often damaging their own machines. Martials tend to be blunt.
Do that before somebody happens to sap their strength.
Because of the features of bluntness and destruction, the Martial type may have to cultivate the harmonious nature of the next type, the Jovial. The planet of influence is Jupiter. The predominant gland is the posterior pituitary. Jovial is a passive, positive type. The physical characteristics of a Jovial are large, rounded machines with round Santa Claus noses. Male Jovials tend toward baldness and may have a paunch later in life. They tend to be cheerful and generally wear bright, flamboyant clothing. Psychologically, Jovials may have a feature of vanity. Similar to the collections of moons around Jupiter, Jovials tend to be collectors. They may have a feature of harmonizing.
I would love for you to stay here again.
With their depth, they tend to begin too many projects and go into periodicity, leaving many of them forgotten or unfinished. They may have a feature of automatic goodness. The last type is the solar, which is found usually in conjunction with other types. For example, a solar Saturnine type. Planet of influence is the sun. The thymus is the gland of influence. Solar is an active, positive type. The physical characteristics are milk and roses complexion and delicate features. Solar may tend to have frail health. Psychologically, a solar may have a childlike disposition, innocence, and may have a feature of vanity.
Never tried it.
They are the Peter Pans and Snow Whites of the world, refusing to grow up. Since the types are affected by each of the glands in the endocrine system, and we need each of them in order to be alive, there are very few pure types. Each of us has some of each type. We see types mostly in transitions, which usually include three types in succession. The largest percentage of inclinations and characteristics tend to be the type we are centered in. For example, a lunar Venusian Mercury may have 40% Venusian, 20% lunar, 20% Mercury, and 5% of the other types. There are three kinds of relationships between the types: maximum attraction, maximum repulsion, and long-lasting relationships. First, the maximum attraction, of which there are three kinds. There's a maximum attraction between the Saturnine and the lunar. This is called a platonic relationship. Where the Saturnine tends toward vagueness, the lunar tends to go into cool instinctive certainty. Where the Saturn tends to dominate a situation, the lunar tends to be timid. The next maximum attraction is between the jovial and mercurial types. Where Jupiter tends to be a mature planet, the Mercury tends to be the baby planet. The jovial tends to mother the Mercury. It is called a familial relationship. The third maximum attraction is between the Venusian and the Martial. The martial adrenal glands, the glands of passion, create an attraction for the sensuous Venusian. The vegetative Venusian tends to admire the courage and vigor of the martial. It is called a carnal or physical relationship. There are several maximum repulsions. The first is between the Mercury and the martial types. They are both negative active types, and both have an excess of sex energy. The Mercury, the repulsion manifests in the form of a quick, explosive crisis. For the Martial, it manifests in the form of rage. Next is the repulsion between the Lunar and the Mercury types. One is passive negative, and the other is active negative. The quick and perceptive Mercury tends to interconsider the cool, instinctive Lunar, and the timid Lunar tends to interconsider the power of the Mercury. Another maximum repulsion is between the Martial and the Lunar, where it is said that the lunar pancreas dampens the fire of the adrenals in the Martial. Another repulsion exists between the ascetic Saturnine and the slothful Venusian. There is another form of relationship that in many cases can prove to be quite a useful one, particularly when both people are working on themselves. It is called a long-lasting relationship, and it happens when one type is a half-step ahead of the other. For example, a Mars jovial lunar and a jovial lunar Venusian. One can see where one has come from, and the other can see where he must go. Each can help the other, and as long as they keep working on themselves, they will remain in a useful relationship with each other. In the event one moves and the other does not, then one may see a change and a separation from the relationship. Often it is said, he is not the same person anymore. Do you see your type?
So, did you have an affinity to a specific type? This area of work is fascinating. It truly explains our lives, both familial, personal, and at large. It gives one insight into why we have the friends we have, what kind of men and women we find ourselves attracted to over and over, as well as why some relationships work and others are doomed to failure from the start. We use celebrities in the video specifically because it can be much easier to see essence type in another person. And with the actors, the better they play their role, the closer they may be to being cast in a role that is true to their essence type. We are all truly actors on a stage, as Shakespeare said. Until you understand essence types and can divide in yourself into two, it will not be possible to shift from where you are. The division of oneself into two refers to the beginning of the process that's called inner separation. Every kind of thought can enter your mind, and every kind of feeling can enter your heart. However, if you ascribe them to yourself and say I to all of them, you fasten them to you and cannot internally separate. For example, we may take negative emotions such as I am mad as simply being that ugly part of ourselves. We each see this happen and we say I to it, believing that that is all there is to us. And the physical sensations that often accompany the negativity compound the feeling of I that comes with the negative emotion. So we begin with self-observation, and that begins to show you the negative emotions and the many I's. And with exercises connected with inner separation, you learn that it is possible to watch these thoughts or feelings passing by as though watching a river, learning to not attach the feeling of yourself to every little thought that crosses your mind.
As you may know, P.D. Uspensky began studying with Gurdjieff in Russia in the early 1900s. And Uspensky wrote his book In Search of the Miraculous, capturing much of these initial meetings. And in one such meeting, Uspensky describes an experiment that Gurdjieff created for the group in order to see the difference between essence and personality in two quite different people. So one of them was an older man who had a strong false personality and a simple, relatively undeveloped essence. And the other was a younger man who usually played the fool in false personality, but at the same time his essence, the real part of him, was actually quite well educated. So I'm going to read the story now from the book In Search of the Miraculous. Conversations in groups continued as usual. Once, G said that he wanted to carry out an experiment on the separation of personality from essence. We were all very interested because he had promised experiments for a long time, but till then we had seen nothing. I will not describe his methods. I will merely describe the people whom he chose that first evening for the experiment. One was no longer young and was a man who occupied a fairly prominent position in society. At our meetings, he spoke much and often about himself, his family, about Christianity, and about the events of the moment connected with the war and with all possible kinds of scandal that had very much disgusted him. The other was younger. Many of us did not consider him to be a serious person. Very often, he played what is called the fool, or on the other hand, entered into endless formal arguments about some or other details of the system without any relation whatever to the whole. It was very difficult to understand him. He spoke in a confused and intricate manner, even about the most simple things, mixing up in a most impossible way different points of view and words belonging to different categories and levels. I pass over the beginning of the experiment. We were sitting in the big drawing room. The conversation went on as usual. Now observe, G whispered to us. The older of the two, who was speaking heatedly about something, suddenly became silent in the middle of a sentence and seemed to sink into his chair looking straight in front of him. At a sign from G, we continued to talk without looking at him. The younger one began to listen to the talk and then spoke himself. All of us looked at one another. His voice had become different. He told us some observations about himself in a clear, simple, and intelligible manner, without superfluous words, without extravagances, and without buffoonery. Then he became silent. He smoked a cigarette and was obviously thinking of something. The first one sat still without moving, as though shrunken into a ball. Ask him what he is thinking about, said G quietly. I? He lifted his head as though waking up when he was questioned. About nothing. He smiled weakly, as though apologizing, or as though he were surprised at anyone asking him what he was thinking about. Well, you were talking about the war just now, said one of us, about what would happen if we made peace with the Germans. Do you still think as you did then? I don't know, really, he said in an uncertain voice. Did I say that? Yes, certainly. You just said that everyone was obliged to think about it, that no one had the right to not think about it, and that no one had the right to forget the war. Everyone ought to have a definite opinion, yes or no, for or against the war. He listened, as though he did not grasp what the questioner was saying. Yes, he said. How odd. I do not remember anything about it. But aren't you interested in it at all? No, it does not interest me at all. Are you not thinking of the consequences of all that is now taking place, of the results for Russia, for the whole civilization? He shook his head as though with regret. I do not understand what you were talking about, he said. It does not interest me at all, and I know nothing about it. Well then, you spoke before of your family. Would it not be very much easier for you if they became interested in our ideas and joined the work? Yes, perhaps, again in an uncertain voice. But why should I think about it? Well, you said you were afraid of the gulf, as you expressed it, which was growing between you and them. No reply. But what do you think about it now? I am not thinking about it at all. If you were asked what you would like, what would you say? Again, a wondering glance. I do not want anything. But think, what would you like? On the small table beside him, there stood an unfinished glass of tea. He gazed at it for a long time, as though considering something. He glanced around him twice, then again looked at the glass, and said in a serious voice, with such serious intonations that we all looked at one another, I think I should like some raspberry jam. Why are you questioning him? Said a voice from the corner, which we hardly recognized. This was the second experiment. Can you not see that he is asleep? And you yourself, asked one of us. I, on the contrary, have woken up. Why has he gone to sleep while you have woken up? I do not know. With this, the experiment ended. Neither of them remembered anything the next day. G explained to us that with the first man, everything that constituted the subject of his ordinary conversation, of his alarms and agitation, was in personality. And when his personality was asleep, practically nothing remained. In the personality of the other, there was also a great deal of undue talkativeness, but behind the personality, there was an essence which knew as much as the personality and knew it better. And when the personality went to sleep, essence took its place to which it had a much greater right. Note that contrary to his custom, he spoke very little, said G. But he was observing all of you and everything that was taking place, and nothing escaped him. But what use is it to him if he also does not remember, said one of us. Essence remembers, said G. Personality has forgotten, and this was necessary because otherwise personality would have perverted everything and would have ascribed all this to itself.
So our situation is well described with that, and what happens is by adolescence, we have developed a fairly strong picture of ourselves. We have acts or standard ways of manifesting in a variety of different situations. And we typically have a few personalities or roles that we use at various times, enabling us to interact with the world around us. And some parts are based on genuine, real interests, while other parts are contrived and based on an internal picture of ourselves. So each thing we do is based on this picture that we have. When we begin to study ourselves, we see that we have no permanent I or part of oneself, which differs from Jones or one's last name. With the passive self-observation, we start to see that there can be a division between I and Jones. This is the beginning of a more solid I, by which we mean something more real and more permanent in ourselves, a kind of observing I.
Jones, as you might call him, is our imaginary picture of ourselves, composed of what we call in the work language our false personality. We put our notion of ourselves into Jones, or whatever one's last name is, and all that we call I. Our false personality is opposed to what is actually real in us, to real I. And our false personality is our wrong idea of ourselves. So this division between I, or what is real, and Jones, or what is false, is practical, because it's necessary to know what you are not. That is, we need to know what our false personality looks like. Everyone who speaks about false personality needs to have some picture of himself in the power of this false personality. We may not know ultimately what we will become, but Jones, or false personality, we can study. So we do have some capacity to do this, and we may see this imaginary picture of ourselves.
So when was the last time that you watched some of the initial auditions for American Idol? These initial shows are especially great examples of people who are caught up in their imaginary picture. Here they've gone for several years thinking that they can sing so well that they ought to be on American Idol. They ought to be America's next idol. No one they knew wanted to burst their bubble and tell them they weren't good enough. And so it was not until they tried out in front of the experts that their imaginary picture or imaginary bubble burst. And although it's a potentially painful process, it is all imaginary. And that is all we have to lose, is the imaginary. So it actually becomes a question of what kind of life you want to be living.
So each of us, each person, has maybe 5 or 6 roles that we continually play. So what stands behind these roles? It is not our real I. Instead, we have this imaginary picture of ourselves, and we have to study it if we want to develop ourselves. It's impossible to have a practical knowledge of yourself if we do not know our false personality. And as long as we think that we are one, that is a unity, all of our definitions are wrong. At some point, when we begin to study ourselves, we realize that false personality gives us a false sense of reality. And it makes us do things which may not be in any way appropriate for us. But because we lack understanding and we lack will, we take these actions anyway, even though they're not actually what our essence would do on its own. But we're unable to change the course of our lives, and we're glued to this outer sense of things, because as you remember, the personality, or the false personality, is the outer shell of ourselves. And the shell is rigid. To be unable to adapt means to be stone, means inflexible.
So the work teaches that man is in a state of multiplicity. For this reason, it is a mistake to think that we are always one and the same. We are never the same for long. We're continually changing. And yet we imagine ourselves to be the same I all the time. And it is difficult for a person to accept from one moment to the next that that I changes. We are convinced that we are a unity, a real person. However, we do not even remain the same for 5 minutes. So we think that if a man is called John, he is always John. But in another moment, he may actually be somebody else. And then a minute later, he's someone else again. And we think he's John. And the whole time we see him changing and manifesting completely different features, all in the same person. And John doesn't even notice. So if you learn to observe these different eyes in yourself, and you see this going on in John, there's no need to go to the movies.
Instead of having a real unity, we have this imaginary unity called imaginary I, which is entirely false. So quite often, two people meet and hope to be happy, but they do not understand that they are actually many. They have many different eyes inside of them, not just one, maybe 1,000 eyes in each. So there's a woman, Jane. She thinks she's marrying John, and John thinks he's marrying Jane. But John and Jane are largely invented people. Each may have this wrong feeling of I, and each is subject to many eyes, and many of their own eyes do not even know each other. And these situations are a source of complication and great unhappiness. So when we work on ourselves, we need to see that our false personality, taken as a whole, is dominant in us, and that as we are, it's the center of gravity of our lives. That is, imaginary I is a fiction of ourselves that we have to maintain whether we like to or not. We have to do all kinds of things to keep up this imaginary picture of ourselves, this false self, so that we don't lose this imaginary sense of ourselves, which is, for most of us, all we have when we start working on ourselves. So, because we don't wish to lose this familiar sense of ourselves, we have to do all these things in false personality. If somehow we're taken out of our false personality, if our false personality was made passive, most of us would become quite disoriented or even worse.
So we start with noticing our affectations, our insincerities, our artificial ways, not to mention false sweet intonations. The false personality and the imaginary I have to be watched by something that is home in one and not accept our personalities as our false personalities as real. In this way, we learn to separate from false personality and make it passive. So false personality is mechanical. You can see that you're distinct from it. You can separate from it. And then you can change internally. That is, an increase in consciousness has taken place. So this work is about increasing consciousness of you, of what you are. If you become more observant of the small fears, the foolish ambitions, the vanity which you have served, that is, your false personality, you begin to approach a test in relation to a higher level of consciousness and awakening from sleep.
Now, the main point about self-observation is that it must be uncritical. We work with our observing eye and begin to see our contradictions. So we study our false personality first by dividing ourselves, by not saying I to everything. So from one point of view, we can only truly use the word I in relation to the more conscious part of ourselves, the more essential part of ourselves, the part of us which wants to understand, which wants to develop. That is a part that we can call I, but at the moment, we have no permanent I, and this is what must be developed, what must grow in us. Now the question arises in relation to our many likes and dislikes, how do we separate what is real and what is false personality? And it is difficult at first, but it's important that pretty much it's all false personality when you first start working on yourself. And it's said that work on oneself begins from the moment that one realizes that one is actually not a unity.
So false personality, this false part of ourselves, is quite elusive. It contains incompatible features that cannot manifest at the same time. Sometimes you can see false personality as a whole. Sometimes you can see most of it. Sometimes you can see features of false personality separately. And oftentimes it's much easier to see someone else's false personality. And sometimes it may be rather attractive or amusing, particularly for people who live in their false personality all of the time. An ironic thing that seems to happen is when you begin to work on yourself and you start to lose your false personality, you begin to struggle with it, your friends will no longer like you. They may say things such as, wow, you've become so boring, or you've become so dull. But when we try to discern what is not false personality, we learn that our false part of ourselves cannot make work efforts. And it tries to make everything as easy as possible. So when you find a group of eyes that are ready to make efforts, it means that they do not belong to that false part of yourself.
Our false personality is the imaginary part of us. It's a pretend person that we like to imagine ourselves to be. It takes itself as a unity. It borrows the idea that it is a real person, and it says I to itself. So we have to see that this aspect of false personality is not actually I. And we have to see that we spend a huge amount of our energy trying to support this imagination about ourselves, thinking that we're something that we're actually quite far from. Because of this constant effort to maintain this false picture of ourselves, we are under quite a bit of stress psychologically. So one easy way to see the false personality is when we say, thank God I'm not like that person. But of course we are just like that person, and the false personality does not want to see what it is actually like. We can imagine everybody walking around with a bubble surrounding them. This bubble protects each person's false picture of themselves, and it emotes, it sends out emotional tentacles to other people about what they're supposed to be thinking, what they're supposed to be saying about us. And it takes a huge amount of energy to keep this bubble inflated. With work on oneself, work against the false personality, we realize that we do not have to support this enormous bubble of imagination about ourselves, And our lives become much easier, much less complicated and simpler. And we can serve energy, and this energy that we save from not having to support our imaginary picture of ourselves becomes available for us to experience higher states, higher emotions.
So we've been talking about the false personality, and the part that's connected with it is the imaginary I. And this is said to be a formulation of the peculiar relationship that we have with ourselves that we call I. Imaginary I prevents us from having any intelligent aim about ourselves. It acts as a powerful hypnotic. And owing to imaginary I, we appear to be real people, unified and definite, with names and careers and positions the same today as yesterday, solid and unshakable. We think sensually, and so we say, "That is me," to the mirror. But in fact, we are looking at an imaginary picture. Our incorrect image, called imaginary I, nourishes inner imaginary pictures of ourselves in negative states. We do not realize that this I does not exist except in imagination. Indeed, the I is composed of imagination. Thus, we are hypnotized into believing that we are one, that we have unity.
It is this imagination that keeps us from realizing that we're actually imagining our life. We're dreaming our way through our own lives. It is this imaginary I that prevents us from seeing anything wrong with ourselves. And it prevents us from seeing the work on ourselves that we need to do in order to develop, to make some progress in our lives. This happens because we take ourselves as one person rather than many little eyes. The imaginary I hides the situation, and it causes a person to believe that they have full will and full consciousness. But in reality, we have nothing directing us. We have no real I. And because our real I is not there, although we could have it if we worked on ourselves, we create this imaginary I. And this imaginary I is what keeps us asleep. So if we realize that we have no real I, no real will, then we're taking the first step towards awakening from our drunken sleep.
So I'm going to read a passage from J.H. Reiner's book, Gurdjieff in Action, and it talks about our situation. Essence is the material of the astral world, which is a timeless realm in which there exist patterns of possibilities, which are the causes of the events of life. It contains innumerable threads interwoven into the fabric, produced by transits of consciousness, which bring into being the events and situations in the phenomenal world. My essence will be responsible for the thread which determines my life. But if it is undeveloped and ill-nourished, it will not have the ability to make any change in the situation. Yet it is aware of the whole pattern, from birth to death. And if it grows in stature, it can modify the path through the eternal fabric to create events which will provide it with better food. This is the idea of recurrence. Since the life, with all its experiences, is brought into being by a transit of consciousness through the pattern existing in the astral world, it is clearly possible for this transit to be repeated. If it is repeated exactly, we shall be born to the same parents, in the same circumstances, and experience the same situations until we die from the same cause. But there is the possibility of other transits, which we will actualize different possibilities, but this we interpret in a complacent hope that perhaps next time may be better. This is mere imagination born of our perpetual hankering for a second chance. We have to learn to use the existing situation, because until we do so, it must be repeated. The life is a pattern of opportunities which the soul has prescribed in its quest for nourishment. But the greatest error in our conventional interpretation of recurrence is the assumption that the transits of consciousness must be consecutive. They can be modified and can only be modified now. So you can see emotionally, without the distraction of reasoning, that a developing essence can create a different path through the pattern and so attract different events. And this can alter the situation now. I do not have to wait for death and a mythical next time. Yet this can only start by providing essence with the food it needs by transforming the experiences of the day. These constitute the ore, which can only be found at this level of earth. And this is why we are down here. We're glad you're able to join us today. You can watch more, find out more, visit us at Facebook, Wisdom Through Action at Facebook, or we have a website, wisdomthroughaction.org. And we will see you next time here on SBN.
Be sure to hop on over to the Spiritual Broadcast Network. It's the go-to place for all things spiritual. You'll discover internet television shows that you won't find anywhere else. You can also choose from hundreds of hours of spiritual documentaries and movies. You'll enjoy on-demand and live internet television programming 24/7. Best of all, we add new dramas, comedies, talk, and reality shows, and more on a daily basis. So why spend countless hours searching the web when you can quickly find just what you want on the Spiritual Broadcast Network?